Welcome to Lawyers in the House with Montlick. Wish you had a lawyer in the family? Now you do. Here's your host, Veronica Waters.
Hello, 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 and welcome to Lawyers in the House with Montlick on WSB. I'm Veronica Waters. Happy to have you back in the house with us for another special episode. Today, we are sitting here with a couple of my favorite attorneys from the Montlick firm, and we're talking about something that really has been documented in history and in fiction dating back for centuries. From Harriet Tubman to Regarding Henry to Aaron Hernandez, whether in real life or on the movie screen, traumatic brain injuries have been documented and talked about, and the way that they affect people's lives and shatter them sometimes is what we're talking about today. And how can a family move forward? How can a person move forward after everything that you are in your head, everything that makes you you, is suddenly in jeopardy? Talking about traumatic brain injuries with me today are two, as I said, amazing and two of my favorite lawyers from Montlick Injury Attorneys. Let's start off here with Mr. Michael Never Give Up Rubin.
Thank you.
Who has been practicing law for how many decades now?
Well, over two.
More than 20 years.
Oh, yeah.
And you've been with Montlick how long, Michael?
Over two decades.
So the whole time, pretty much.
Yeah, essentially, except for 6 months between law school and finding the best place to work I could imagine.
Yeah, so Michael's reputation for caring for his clients and caring most about their well-being and checking on them and seeing how they're doing is pretty much unparalleled at the firm. He really likes to fight for justice, but he also wants to make sure that his clients are just simply feeling okay. Michael came to Montlick after the University of Maryland.
That's correct.
And Terps. New England Law. Go That's Terps. Right. Okay. And once told us all, if you remember this, your passion for helping people came from your granddad.
That's exactly right.
Watching your granddad.
That's right. That's right. My grandfather practiced for twice as long, more than three times as long as I have.
Wow.
At this point. He was, and just the stories he would tell about being able to help people in a small town where he was, or at that time it was small, was just so impressive. And I just, I looked up to it and thought, wow, that's a very noble profession, something that you can actually do to help people and inform people of their rights.
How did you know what field of law you wanted to go into, though?
There's very few areas where you get to represent purely victims. And, you know, we call them plaintiffs or injured, but really they're victims because they're the ones that are hurt and they didn't cause this. So you have the victims, and it's really, I mean, if you look at the law, I'm sure everyone who's being sued or whatever has a right to a defense, but the people that are involved in injuries, however they get them, if it's not their fault, they're victims of some type of, you could say, violence. Some violent, it's not what we traditionally think about violence, but it's still a violent injury that somebody has. So this gave me the opportunity, being on the plaintiff side, to, you know, really help people, the people that are hurt, instead of helping corporations. Not that they don't have a right to the help either, but mm-hmm. I think I'd rather deal with people.
Yeah.
Like personal, on a personal level.
And did you know right away that you were doing the right thing for you?
Not until I met Alan.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, I really had no idea what this type of field would be like, or what. And, you know, 25 years ago, things were looked at a little differently in our profession in terms of billboards and certain things. Now, I mean, it's the only way people will really understand they have a case or have the right. So it's not for the person who, you know, has a brother who's an attorney. It's for the person who doesn't know an attorney or even know that there's a potential case. And that's become so much more accepted that that's out there to help people. So I had no idea where I would go, where anything would go. And thankfully, through Alan and David, I mean, just the core values of the firm are just so impressive that they're I just knew right away that this was the fit. No matter, didn't matter about the other things. I just knew it was a right fit in terms of my values and what I wanted to do to try to help people.
And what a lead in to our next guest, Alan Saltzman. Alan, are you getting a little misty over there? Alan Saltzman, managing attorney at Montlick Injury Attorneys. What in the world goes through your mind when you hear that? I mean, you, I know, have preached for decades about the importance of ethics, the importance of integrity. If you look at reviews of Alan's work, if you listen to clients, they all talk about his integrity and his care being so incredibly unrivaled, his professionalism, his knowledge of the law. And now you're hearing that as you help staff this place, Alan, you know, the folks around you see it up close and personal.
Well, thank you. Thank you for saying that. And Michael is truly a throwback, because when I came to Montlick & Associates way back in 1987, I was practicing law all over the place, criminal law, corporate law, buying and selling businesses. But I met David Montlick, and I loved his ethics. I loved his values. The one thing he said to me that stuck in my mind was that we have a firm where we want to handle every case just like it was our own case. And that resonated with me. And I've been doing it ever since. A lot of firms, people call, they don't actually get to talk to a lawyer. And the show today is about brain injuries. And this is a very important injury. I call it the hidden injury. Because if you call a call center, you don't know you have this. You may not know it 3 or 4 days later. And that initial interview with an actual attorney is so important. And when you get somebody on the phone like Michael Rubin, who will do a head-to-toe interview with you, and you may be complaining about neck or back injuries, and Michael will say, did you hit your head? And the person will say, you know what, I did. And Michael will say, where? Well, on the roof of my car, I hit the light, or I hit the window in my cab. And we watch for that. We watch for the symptoms that might unfold even though the client is not articulating them right away. If you call a law firm and you get a call center, you're not going to get that kind of attention. So I call this the hidden injury because it isn't apparent. People don't know they have it.
Crusader Alan Saltzman,
yes,
who I know turned to personal injury law. Isn't that,
oh, yeah,
that's his personality.
Like it. Oh,
it's
no,
actually
it
what brought him into the law, right?
Yes,
you wanted
is.
You wanted to
Thank
make
you,
sure
is.
That the, you know, as I said before in another episode, you're kind of like, in some instances, the law and the order. You're like the police, you know, and the prosecutor when it comes to, we were talking about product liability and how important it is for laws to actually help people, you know. University of Pittsburgh, Western State University College of Law, top 100 civil. What does that mean, top 100 civil trial lawyer?
He's amazing.
Right, yeah, that sounds...
It means that we have experience, it means that we care, and that we get results.
Alan Saltzman and Michael Rubin, Montlick Injury Attorneys, here with us on Lawyers in the House with Montlick. Thanks so much for being in the house, fellas. As you introduced us to it, mm-hmm, traumatic brain injury, something that we have seen, as I said, in real life, and on the movie screen. One of my favorite movies when I was younger was Regarding Henry, starring Harrison Ford. We were, mm-hmm, just talking about how I've never seen an Indiana Jones movie. Please don't tweet me on that. I'm going to. Regarding Henry told the story of this sort of vicious lawyer who would do anything to win a case. And suddenly he found himself shot in the head, the victim of an armed robbery. Mm. Harrison Ford played this character so wonderfully. At the time, I don't know if I ever heard the term traumatic brain injury, but it changed his personality completely. And he became this much more compassionate guy. He was so much gentler with his wife. He was so much gentler with his son. And, you know, happily ever after, you know, off into the sunset. But what I know just from talking to you guys, even before we cracked open the mics, is that traumatic brain injuries often don't manifest in such a, I don't want to say a gentle way, because that definitely was not a gentle way that his character got it. But sometimes it doesn't change you for the better.
Right.
It makes your life a lot worse.
Right, right. They sort of creep in over time. A client will call and he won't tell you that he has head injuries. His wife will call his sister will call and say, my brother, my husband just isn't the same. And we tell our legal assistants to be very attuned to that. Our paralegals know this as well. When you call in, when somebody calls on the phone and they say that their husband or their wife or their loved one is not the same, immediately we want to get an attorney on the phone with them to examine why. And often there is denial about that. These people that have blows to the head, concussions, a concussion is a type of traumatic brain injury that's caused by a blow to the head. There is something called cerebrospinal fluid in your head that gives you some protection. But when you hit your head hard, you can have an injury. And there are sharp points in your skull, in your brain. And there isn't much room there, and the brain begins to swell. And people start noticing symptoms like memory loss, double vision, imbalance, numbness, nausea, headaches. They can't sleep. There's a change in their personality. These are all signs that we look for, and usually the client will deny those signs.
Because maybe they don't sense them themselves, right?
Yes, and they become very abusive even to us. We're trying to help them, and they become abusive to us. They make an appointment with us on a Wednesday and swear that it was for Tuesday, walk in on Tuesday, and maybe yell at our staff.
For not getting the schedule right, and they just don't know what they're experiencing.
And doctors don't see these things sometimes.
How is that? How you would define a traumatic brain injury? Are we leaping ahead? How do you define it? What's a TBI?
Really, I mean, the way I look at it is, anytime you hit your head, I don't care what it is, there's the potential for a TBI. And the only reason I say that is that there's you don't know what's under there. You don't know your predisposition to anything. And someone may be more susceptible to a concussion than somebody else. Someone may be able to bang their head 20 times on the wall and won't do anything, but someone bangs their head one time, and as Alan was saying, the brain hits the wall of the skull. And that's, you know, maybe it does nothing. Maybe it's just, boom, and you're fine. But
even a concussion is a TBI.
Yes. No, that's where I think people, the confusion or the, you know, TBI sounds horrible, right? Traumatic brain injury.
It does.
Right? Concussion just sounds better. Well, you have a concussion. But a concussion is a traumatic brain injury. And you really have to, as I'm just reiterating, because it is this important, you have to have people watching you. You have to have somebody looking after you. I don't, like the old thing that we've heard, you know, if you have a concussion, don't fall asleep the night for the night, or have somebody watch you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, in a way, it's almost true that the reason is because you may not feel the effects or know. The person may not know.
Mm-hmm.
Someone has to look for it. And as an attorney, Mom, we have, I mean, I hate to say, but basically a checklist.
Head, you have a checklist.
Nose, ears, mouth. We try to get everything. And what I tell people is, I don't care if you think it's related to this incident or not. If it hurts, tell the doctor. Let them figure out.
All right, let's put a pin in that. Head, shoulders, knees, and toes, talking about traumatic brain injuries and how to sniff them out, coming up on Lawyers in the House. Exactly what lawyers are going to ask about to excavate TBIs.
You're listening to our podcast, Lawyers in the House with Montlick. Join us 8 a.m. every Sunday if you want to listen live on 95.5 WSB.
Welcome back to Lawyers in the House with Montlick on WSB. I'm Veronica Waters, here with Montlick injury attorneys Alan Saltzman and Michael Rubin. We're talking about traumatic brain injuries, and we've heard of these before, right? You hear about football players getting concussions all the time, BMX drivers, hockey players. I mean, there's a whole movie talking about the traumatic brain injury that is the quote-unquote concussion, right? But how does that show up in the field of law? And what do you look for when something comes to you? You were just telling me, Michael, sometimes it's just about a Q&A.
Oh, well, I think that it's not sometimes. It's always.
Always about a Q&A.
In the sense that you really need, if someone's hurt, you really need to talk to them. I don't care. I didn't hit my head, but there was a possibility that they could have. Like, let's say their airbag came out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't hit my head.
Good point, Michael.
But the odds are you did hit your head on that airbag.
Sometimes it's obvious. A head injury is very obvious.
Right. I think that
if you lose consciousness, yeah, it's obvious.
Right. Right.
If you have stitches in your head, if you have glass in your forehead, it's obvious.
I'm bleeding from my head,
right.
Probably.
Not so obvious if your neck and back are hurting and that's your main concern.
Right. Right. And I think the body sometimes tricks us. You know, the thing that hurts the most is what you're feeling. And then when that, you eventually you'll feel other things. Or you may be concentrating on one part of your body and trying to make that feel better and not right. really knowing what's going on. And a head injury can, while a broken arm is, and you can, you know, it's there. A head injury is just happening in an area that you have no idea over time. It could be a ticking time bomb in the sense that you have something there that is slowly getting worse and worse and could be diffused much easier if it was recognized. There's no cure for concussions, but there is things that can be done to help the person and to rehabilitate them. And recognizing the symptoms and everything is the first step anyway in healing.
You told me that you had a case involving a little kid that stuck with you.
Yeah, he was 7 years old in the back seat, and an ambulance made an illegal maneuver, struck the car, and he ended up a quadriplegic. And essentially, the head injury, it severed his spinal cord. Also, there was head trauma as well. And this is a child that needs 24-hour care, all these things, all because of a spinal head injury. I mean, they're intertwined in some way because the spine, it connects up there at some point to the brainstem, which is part of. So that's when there's an injury there, more times than not, you'll know that type of serious. But any other, I would say 9 times out of 10, you won't even know you have a head injury.
9 times out of 10, you may not know you have a traumatic brain injury. So how do these attorneys sniff it out? We're talking to Alan Saltzman and Michael Rubin here on Lawyers in the House with Montlick, investigating head injuries. Coming up next on Lawyers in the House.
You're listening to our podcast, Lawyers in the House with Montlick. Join us 8 a.m. every Sunday on 95.5 WSB.
Welcome back to Lawyers in the House with Montlick on WSB. I'm Veronica Waters here talking about traumatic brain injuries with Montlick injury attorneys Alan Saltzman and Michael Rubin. And if you missed any of the great nuggets in the first half of the show, make sure you just check us out on your favorite podcast platform for the replay or on YouTube, where you can also see our smiling faces. And remember, you can reach us 24/7 and send us a question if you log on to lawyersinthehouse.com and follow us on every social media platform at Montlick Law. We would love to see you there. TikTok you or tweet you or Facebook you or whatever, or IG you, whatever the case may be, at Montlick Law. Michael and yes. Alan, we're talking about traumatic brain injuries. And I mentioned at the start of the show that these have been documented throughout history and they've been dramatized in movies and television. I mentioned Harriet Tubman, who was about 12 years old when someone, an overseer who was throwing a 2-pound lead weight at another slave, missed that guy and hit little Harriet in the head. She suffered a brain injury that affected her for the rest of her life. She had narcolepsy, migraines, hallucinations, and she, interestingly enough, history nugget, ran away in part because she was believing that her unattractiveness as a slave being bought because of her physical symptoms might cause her to be separated from her family. So she ran to freedom. And then, of course, we know she ran the Underground Railroad for years after that. So many things about the great Harriet Tubman. Oh, yeah. But and we also mentioned here regarding Henry after we talked about Harriet Tubman. It's been fictionalized. Virgin River. There's a TV show called Virgin River where a character had a TBI and her personality has changed. Her family's personalities have changed as they've tried to do things like remind her that you were on the way to this friend's funeral when you were in this accident that caused this traumatic brain injury that makes you not able to remember that your friend is dead now. It's like, how much can a brain injury not only affect your life, but affect the lives of those around you? And how do you excavate that?
Let me give you an example, Veronica. I had a young man one time that was involved in a rear-end collision on I-75, and he had a failure of his seatbelt, his head hit the windshield, his forehead was bleeding, they dug glass out of his eyes, but he was mainly concerned with his neck and back injuries, which were pretty serious by themselves. over time in handling the case, I got a call from his wife, and she said he just wasn't the same. I said, well, what do you mean? He says he's listless. He's tired all the time. He doesn't want to go out. He's spending more time with the dog than usual. He had a dog whom he loved. She said, I'm just telling you he's different. So I got on the phone and I'd call him, and he would get very mad at me. And one of these days, I gave him a call, and he said, I just lost my job. So two things are happening here. He lost his job, and his marriage started to fail. And it turned out that his marriage resulted in a divorce. And the insurance company is not buying the rain injury that I knew was there. I saw the spider webbing on the windshield. They said, we'll be responsible for the neck and the back. And you have the MRI on the neck and the back, but we're not buying the brain injury. And he called up one day. I'm 2 years into handling this case now. And he has been very eccentric, very mean to my staff. Using curse words, he would not stop, and he called me on a particular Wednesday, and he said, you haven't done a darn thing for me, and I maybe had 200 conversations with him documented over the last 2 years. He said, I'm getting another lawyer, and you're fired. Well, I got in my car, and I went to his house. I knocked on the door, and he was feeding his German Shepherd raw chicken from the supermarket, peeling off plastic. And everybody knows, if you love your dog could choke. I saw that this was confirmation in my mind of what I was thinking all along, that he had a brain injury. He refused to see a neuropsychologist. And a neuropsychologist is concerned with relationships between the brain and your behavior. I called 911. He was picked up, taken to the hospital, and he got the treatment that he needed. And he got a policy limits recovery because he was different. He was changed, and he needed treatment very badly. So all's well that ends well, but he was never quite the person that he was before the accident happened.
Talk about being able to have the lives of the people around you changed because of that. You know, because we've talked a lot about the mental aspects of a TBI, you know, the way that it manifests in some physical symptoms even to yourself, maybe the headaches or the dizziness, the lethargy, that kind of thing. But also when you have a traumatic brain injury, it can affect your mobility. It affects the way you move through the world. Having to, this character I mentioned on Virgin River has to use a cane as she's learning how to walk again, how to talk again. And it's, you know, it changes you and everybody around you.
Right. And you may be able to do jumping jacks and play football. You can still do things, but you're different. A neuropsychologist can examine you. They can look at your IQ prior to the accident, and they can give you tests and see how you've changed. Mm-hmm. They can find out how you are different. And there are wonderful resources in Atlanta, such as the Shepherd Spinal Institute, that people can go to and get referrals. And if anybody has a loved one or a family member that shows symptoms of a head injury, they should see somebody as soon as possible.
And don't think that you necessarily, as you mentioned earlier, are going to see it right away. Sometimes it takes a while to manifest itself. The Ohio State University's Wexner Medical Center and College of Medicine has looked at 25 years worth of data and found that traumatic brain injuries are not something that you can consider acute anymore. These are chronic conditions that will last for years and years and years and years.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's going to keep going on. But I actually, getting back to something you said, you know, these TV shows, you know, I'm sure they're sensationalized, but in a way it's good because it's making people more aware of these types of injuries. Not having seen them, I don't know the nuances, but it does, the more people are aware of potential problems, especially something is, this isn't like, okay, well, you may have a sprained finger. Okay, well, if you ignore it, what's the worst that's going to happen? Maybe you lose use of that finger, but I doubt it. But if you ignore a brain injury, you can't do anything. Like, our bodies, like, you can be hurt anywhere and hopefully do something with your head, like be able to talk and communicate. But if that's gone and everything else is great, it's much more difficult to survive and to live, especially on the family.
So when you guys are sort of getting to the bottom of this, you're not only talking to the person, probably most of whom you never know before you see them. So you have to depend on what? The testimony, if you will, the experiences of their friends, their family, their coworkers, their bosses, their military records, their school records. Like, who was this person before and after?
You also need to read if there's an EMS trip report. Does it say he hit his head? You need to look, like Alan said, look at the car. If you have pictures, was there spider webbing anywhere? Did the airbag deploy? Were they wearing a seatbelt? Many things. The size.
Did the seatbelt fail?
Right. The size of the vehicle. You know, a smaller car, you're going to be closer to your, A-pillars or whatever they are. In a big Lincoln Town car, I'm dating myself, you're going to have a lot more room between you and hitting something. So most of the time, I got to imagine in a car wreck, you're going to hit your head, whether it's the back of the headrest, whether it's the side of the head. I mean, some way your head and neck are moving. It's not, they're not bolted on. That kind of injury, and it all can sort of flow, like up, like with it, because, you know, you hurt your neck. Well, that's pretty darn close to your head and brain.
Very good point.
You probably hurt. And what's interesting also is a lot of people say their neck hurts, but it's their shoulder, or the opposite. My shoulder hurts, but it's their neck.
That could be a brain injury, perhaps, with the nerves sending the signals to your brain that, you know, they could be damaged.
Well,
one part of it's telling you that something's hurting when it's really something else that's injured.
Well, yeah.
We're not doctors. We're lawyers and we're advocates.
I wanted to go to med school, just FYI. No.
You'd have been an amazing
doctor. I need a good doctor, Barney.
Your bedside manner would have been impeccable.
Thank you, gentlemen.
We're in the proof business. And one time I had a client who called and said he had double vision and insisted it was caused by the accident. He had other injuries from the accident as well. And we suggested that he see an ophthalmologist. The ophthalmologist looked into his eye and saw something organic. He saw a tumor that was growing. And it was, luckily for him, it was a meningioma, a tumor that can be ultimately scooped up and out and taken out. And as a result of getting the treatment that he needed, he saved himself from the consequences of a brain tumor. He could have died. So it never hurts to get treatment.
Right.
And we're all about proof. If somebody tells me that they're having issues, I'm listening. And if we can suggest the right kind of treatment for them, they're on their way.
It's all about listening to your lawyer too, isn't it, Michael?
Yeah. I think it's also listening to yourself, because most of us know, but we ignore our own, like, oh, I know I need to go to the doctor, but I don't feel like going today.
But what about the client who may have a TBI and
right.
is like, well, there's nothing wrong with me.
That's right. To that point only multiplies that.
Yeah.
So think about how hard it is to get someone like that. And Alan makes a very good example of sometimes you end up arguing, and we never want to argue with our clients. I mean, we care about them and fight for them, but they don't. That's how they're communicating with
us. You never think fighting for your client is going to mean fighting with your client, right?
Right, but sometimes the first goal always, and I tell them, is getting you better or getting the person better. And then the next goal is, okay, let's work on a recovery to compensate you for what you've gone through, if it's it. But no money helps you get better. It's the treatment that helps you get better. Any money or recovery is to compensate you for the misery that your life was, but it's really about getting you better. That's secondary.
Tell me a case that sticks with you.
Young lady who was pregnant and in a car and passenger, and her boyfriend, the father of the unborn child, got distracted and hit a tree, and she ended up with as severe a brain injury as you can basically get without being in a coma. So she was at Shepherd Center, Alan mentioned it. It's an amazing place when it comes to these types of things. The care they give the children, or the injured, excuse me, this just happened to be a child, and the care and the support they give the family is really what amazes me. But she had a brain injury to the point where she was flailing, nothing, pregnant the whole time. They treat her. She starts to talk. She recovers. To the point, you know, she's never going to fully recover, but to the point where she has a healthy baby throughout this process, can move home, can be on her own for the most extent. But if on an injury like that, that's evident, right? I mean, she was immediately. That's an extreme example. But someone could get to that point where she was by having a minor injury in the beginning. Mm-hmm. That's the scary thing with these. A broken something, worst is you're going to need surgery on that little part. But a head is much different.
Mm-hmm. And as you said, it can culminate that swelling, those symptoms, all of that stuff that you do and don't feel, the stuff that you do feel, the stuff that you don't know about, it could culminate in a real tragedy sometime after the fact of the accident. So thank you so much for painting that picture for me, Alan Saltzman, Michael Rubin. Coming up, the MCA is on the way, the Montlick closing argument just around the corner on Lawyers in the House with Montlick. Stay with us.
You're listening to our podcast, Lawyers in the House with Montlick. If you want to listen to our radio show live, you can hear it every Sunday, 8 a.m. on 95.5 WSB.
And welcome back one more time to Lawyers in the House with Montlick on WSB. I'm Veronica Waters here with Montlick injury attorneys Michael Rubin and Alan Saltzman, here with what you've been waiting for all hour long, the Montlick closing argument. Gentlemen, the floor is yours.
Sure. So I think the first thing to start out with is that if you hit your head, I don't care what it's on, or someone hits you in the head. I mean, however it happens, go to a doctor. Get checked out. I mean, urgent care. It doesn't matter. Just have somebody look at you to look for the signs, blurry vision, things right away. Now, that doesn't mean they're going to find it either. So then you got to have somebody else watching you. And I think Alan can get into some of that about how it's important for people to keep an eye.
It's really important, and I think we've pointed out how important it is to get treatment first. We're not doctors, we're lawyers, but if you do know somebody that was involved in an accident and had a potential brain injury or just bad injuries from an accident, they should call a lawyer who listens, a lawyer who cares, a lawyer without a call center who's going to talk to you. You can call a very large law firm, and you can call a call center, and they might not ever ask you if you hit your head. But we ask you if you hit your head. And if you say yes, we're on it. Michael is watching for possible symptoms in the future, and he's going to suggest treatment for you so your case doesn't languish in a pod as a soft tissue injury case when there actually could be a brain injury lurking. So it's really important to get treatment. It's really important to get good advice after that treatment.
Sure. And I think getting to that fact, I review, and I mean, I think I speak for all of the attorneys in our office, that when a medical record comes in on a client, I take a look at it. I may not, you know, you can look at something and see, okay, well, whoa, head injury. And the client never even told you. So you have to actually work the case. And if the case is given to a call center, that call center may decide where it funnels through that firm, and it may go somewhere that doesn't give that person what they deserve.
And we are a large firm for a personal injury plaintiff's law firm, but we are all about personal attention, and we are all about listening to you.
Well, that gets back to the core values that I said. It really is. That the whole goal is to make these people feel comfortable. They've probably never gone through anything like this, especially if it's a head injury, a severe. You want them to feel part of our family in some way.
Michael said the other day, we don't have egos.
Yeah, no.
Right? We just want to get to the bottom of things and help people.
Right.
Yeah. And if I'm a friend or a family member of somebody who has seen someone suffer an injury like this, or who has seen, if I see a personality change or something, it's up to me, too, to maybe speak up and make that call.
Don't be afraid.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid of them ridiculing you because it's that important.
It's that important. Michael Rubin, Alan Saltzman, Montlick Injury Attorneys, here with Lawyers in the House with Montlick on WSB. I'm Veronica Waters. Thanks for being with us. We will see you in the House next time.
You're listening to our podcast, Lawyers in the House with Montlick. Catch us live every Sunday, 8 a.m. on 95.5 WSB.